Non solo Anima TV è con Bill Holman, erede diretto del teschio di Anne Mitchell Hodges. Labanatum, 1977. During archaeological excavations, one of the most famous crystal skulls was found, the skull of Anne Mitchell Hodges, which has a controversial history.
There is a lot of controversy about the skull. That's what makes it special. And the controversy is good because it makes people think. But what it really is, in being around it and understanding it and knowing Anna Mitchell Hodges and knowing her father's life, they were very special and very amazing people. And just like the skull is, it's something that once you see it, you never forget it. It's very special. And they say it was found in Lubantun, and some people say it isn't or whatever. But the real proof is that, you know, that's what she said. She found it there. She was there. And so, you know, what can you say, you know, because there's no one alive that was there at the time, you know. But the Mayans that I've talked to that were down on the site remember the Mitchell Hodges being there. They remember all the things happening that, you know, so it's what they said and what she said, I believe.
Can you tell us about your first approach with the skull Mitchell Hodges?
Sometimes things are destined in people. Certain people have their destiny, and I feel that the skull was part of my destiny and something that I have been given as a opportunity or a legacy to carry on the life and the beliefs of Anna Mitchell Hodges and her father. And with the skull, I feel it is a tool for mankind, and it's for opening people to a universal consciousness of love. And it's my responsibility to bring it around like I'm here today. I go to different parts of the world because I feel that it's a way of helping people. And I see the people that see it, and it changes their life and makes their life better. And it's a really good feeling for me. And so I really like what I do.
Which is the true story of the skull? And how much important is to know where does it come from? And when was it manufactured? As different hypotheses and beliefs exist at the moment.
I think the real essence of the skull is what it is and what it does for people. The energies that they feel, the essence of it is what really, really counts, and where it was found or where what happened or where it came from. There's so many different stories. The Mayans believe that it was brought to their continent by a people that was before their time. It was people with blue hair and blue eyes and blonde hair that brought it to their continent at the beginning of their time. And the Hopi Indians have the same tradition, is what they believe. So where it came from and who really brought it, it's pretty much my guess is as good as yours. So that's.
Can you shortly describe the manufacture and explain us why do you believe it forged in crystal?
See, there's been many tests done on it, and some of the most in-depth tests were done in 1970 at Hewlett-Packard in California laboratories. And Hewlett-Packard were the experts of the time in computer technology and the use of crystal. And their scientists looked at the skull and they performed a series of tests. And one of the tests they performed where they were able to determine that it was made out of piezoelectric quartz crystal, a crystal that is the same type of crystal that they use in computers, little computer chips. And also they determined by putting it into an alcohol solution, which matches the reflective characteristics of the crystal, that it was indeed crystal, and they were able to see with polarized light that the lines of the head went into the jaw in such a perfect manner that they were able to say that the jaw and the head, which are two separate pieces, are of the same crystal, which makes it an impossibility. With a scientist today trying to duplicate it, it would be near impossible. And how it was made, you know, people say it was made in the 20s, or it was made in this. The technology of the skull, this had to be made in some place where it was like zero gravity. So If they had zero gravity capabilities in the 20s, well, maybe it was made in the 20s, but I say it was either brought or had some people with higher knowledge and higher technology than we imagine today. We have a tendency to think that we're the most advanced people ever on the planet. I think that there's a little bit of history that if we really looked into the old history, that some of the ancient people had some very advanced techniques and wisdom.
What did you feel the first time you saw it?
It was like meeting an old friend is what it was to me. It was like a real connection. And I saw pictures of it before and I was just kind of drawn to it. But in really seeing it, there was just that, it was just a warm recognition that I felt that was really pretty amazing. It's something I'll never forget.
You made some meditation experiments on the skull. Can you tell us about that experience?
There's a young lady from, well, she has a scientific research facility in Germany. Her name is Karen Taug. The technologies that she has, she's able to put on camera the energy transfer between people and objects. And so with the meditation and the crystal, we were able to see how the crystal energy expands through the whole crowd and through the whole people and how it ties the people together. It's really amazing. It's something you have to see. It's really pretty neat.
You affirm the skull is here to help us and to help our connection with higher levels of expanded consciousness. If it is so, in which way?
All skulls are important and they all have a job. The Mitchell-Hedges skull, one of its things that it does very well is it works on the heart of man. And what the Indians say, that they want to melt the ice in the heart of man, okay, and open people up to realize, hey, we're all connected. We're all of universal consciousness. We're a part of God. We're all a part of each other. All animal life, all plant life, all human life are connected, and we have that connection. And we, by realizing that and bringing that out, in this time that we live in, there's so much change. And they call the Mayans call it the 2012 connection. We need to be able to open up to this love and bring that to all mankind. And it's a very special thing. And the crystal skull is no more than a tool. It's an entity. It's a tool for mankind. And they've been brought out, according to legend, at a time of great need in the planet. And they're here to help mankind. And it's my responsibility, as I've taken on, to be able to open it up to people that are interested to be able to experience it and see it. And I feel that if we can change the hearts of a small group of people and have them spread out over the world and send that love out, a group of people could have a major effect on the world, and it needs it very much right now.
What secret messages, truths, or codes are closed in this symbol, so mystic and touching for a human being?
The shape of the skull made into crystal is the shape of a human skull. And in the West, sometimes it has a connotation of something not all so good. But according to the ancients and the Mayans and their beliefs, it's the embodiment of wisdom and knowledge. And they feel that, the man's skull is made a certain shape. And that certain shape has a reason. It was made that way by God. And they feel that when they make the crystal into that shape, it has, it takes on that there's a lot of consciousness transfer just by the shape itself. And people that have worked with crystal have found that by shaping a crystal into the shape of a skull, the energy points that are in the skull increases much more than just a regular piece of crystal. So we don't know why that is, but that is a real scientific thing.
Why, in your opinion, some institutions worked to prove with the studies and researches that the found skulls were falses?
I'm not sure exactly why they push it so much and go to such lengths to try to prove stuff like that. There must be a reason why they're pushed that way. But I feel that anytime there's something that's important, there's always a force on the other side that works in the other direction. But I like that there was a test that we made. I made a test with the with the Smithsonian in Washington, D.C., and it was we worked with a electron microscope, and we did the same test that they performed on the British Museum skull. But I did the test for more than one reason, and one of the reasons was I feel the British Museum skull is a very special and very ancient and old skull, and I don't think that they're not giving it the respect and the proper way that it should be treated as far as what it is. And so they couldn't find anything anywhere on the skull, but they did find some markings around the teeth and the jaw, and they say because of that. But see, the thing is, this skull is in two pieces. It was tested, and the jaw and the skull are the same piece of crystal. And there's no way to make that separation with the tools even of today, because any kind of vibration or any kind of heat, crystal is very strong, but it is also brittle, and it would cause it to crack and destroy. And so by it sitting here like this and being here, it's like a miracle unto itself. Okay, if they did make it, how did they do it? It's not possible. And then also the fact is, with the different things that are built into it, and the fact that it was made in a way that crystal is supposed to be cut in a certain way, and it was made in against the natural patterns of crystal. So many different things have come up that make it say, I think they need to re-look at the British Museum skull, because I think it's very special. I think the Paris skull is very special. And I think mankind needs to take these tools and use it for their good right now, because that's what they're for.